Planet Rock. All right, Steelhouse 2018, Ian Danta here for Planet Rock backstage with Scott Gorham of Black Star Riders. A very good evening to you, sir.
Thank you very much. It looks like the weather is just now starting to clear. We'll see if it holds.
But you got experience of Steelhouse because you were here with Black Star Riders 4 years ago. Can you remember possibly whether it was?
No, I've actually talked to a couple of fans out here that were there.
Yeah,
and it was a really nice day. You know, so we got lucky on that one, right?
Just goes to show you, festivals, you are completely in the lap of the gods.
You are. With
now,
everything.
Now, you've come a long way, baby.
I'm trying to.
Yeah. I mean, look, I grew up with Thin Lizzy, my two brothers. The first album they ever owned was Live and Dangerous. So as a 5-6-year-old kid, I was indoctrinated into what you were doing
before. It's funny. I've met so many people that's how they got introduced to Thin Lizzy, was through their older cousin or older brother and all that. So, you know, grabbing them by the scruff of the neck saying, bang, listen to this. This is what you want to listen to.
Yeah.
And that's how... Initially, a lot of the younger guys like yourself got into Thin Lizzy. So thank God for the older brothers and older cousins and all that.
You know? Because
they were too young to get into the show.
And thank you for calling me younger. That's really nice. That means. But you made this gutsy decision, 6 years ago now, to go with Black Star Riders and actually have a different perspective on things and sort of cast the Thin Lizzy thing somewhat to one side.
Right.
How do you feel that's vindicated sort of 6 years on?
I still think that was absolutely the right way to go, the right thing to do. And yes, we were at one point, we were thinking about doing another Thin Lizzy album. But, you know, as time rolled on, I just personally became more and more uncomfortable with that whole way of thinking. Especially because, you know, it's my buddy Phil, man. He was the guy that introduced me to all of this stuff. And I'm going to go out and take the name and record another album without him standing in the middle.
Yeah.
I just got too uncomfortable with that. And I had to voice that opinion to everybody else who was involved with it at the time. And to be quite honest, I think everybody was actually relieved because you know they didn't want to have to compete with other Thin Lizzy albums, and we knew that probably some of the fans were not going to like it. So I didn't want to alienate anybody.
Of course. But you pay homage to Lizzy, of course, and Ricky's got a great voice for that sort of stuff, and it's all part of the set. But of course, it's all about what you've done since, with Heavy Fire, the last album. How creative do you still feel at this point in your career? How much more do you feel you've got to give?
There's still a bit of juice left in the tank.
I got
a few riffs that are coming out. I've already showed them to the guys, and everybody's jumping all over them, right? So I think we're due to start recording it'll be our fourth album?
Yeah, right? That's right.
Damn. In February.
Okay.
So we're already, I think Ricky, lyrically, has probably got 3/4 of the album already written, right? It's just down to us, collaborating with, the chord sequences and the riffs and whatever, if we're going to do, put harmony bits in there and all that, right?
So, sure.
So we're a pretty well-oiled machine on that side of it,
He's a busy boy as well, isn't he, Ricky? I've never known anybody like him. I know!
If he's not playing electric guitar, he's playing the acoustic guitar. Gigs all over the place. I mean, that would just flatten me.
But that must really inspire you when you see somebody like Ricky, who you've got used to working with him. He's your pal.
Yep.
But I guess you must take a step back. I go, man, was I ever like that when I was in my 20s and 30s?
You kind of do have to take a look at Ricky. And he's just an absolute ball of energy, this guy. He just never quits. He rarely has like a sort of negative way of looking at things. He'll always find the positive spin to a terrible situation, right? Which kind of pisses me off sometimes because I want to get angry. Come on, Ricky, be angry with me.
Well, he's sort of a very important focal point for the band, which kind of takes the pressure off you a little bit because, you can just...
I can just stand there.
Yeah. Strap on
the guy on the left.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, the guy on the left with the famous Les Paul and,
There you go. No, Ricky, he is a real focal point of Black Star Riders. And I enjoy that, right? Because he's really good at it. Well, and he really enjoys being that guy.
I seem to remember Phil saying you were going to be the next president of the United States of America on Baby Drives Me Crazy. Is that ever going to happen?
No. seeing what Trump is going through and all that, and what he's doing, I don't want any part of that.
No, okay. No, you it's an easier life, isn't it, staying out of that? So new album will be started next year.
Right.
So that'll be album number 4. It's great. You still have the fire. It's wonderful to see.
Yeah, I love getting out there and playing. There's the, everybody keeps saying, you must have the best job in the world, and you kind of don't want to say that, but you really do have the best job in the world. It's so cool. How many jobs do you know of people at the end of their working day they get up and they applaud you? That just doesn't happen. Right?
Doesn't happen to me. No.
So, you gotta love it.
If you love your job, you'll never work a day in your life. Isn't that right?
Very good. Can I use that?
If you're more than welcome. Huh? Checks in the post, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Good man. Scott Gorham of Black Star Riders with us, going on stage very shortly here at Steelhouse Festival for 2018. Planet Rock.